bogus pretenders. And as you know, Srila Narayana Maharaj recently published his Hindi Bhagavad Gita, and that Hindi Bhagavad Gita is from the original that I believe came from Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur's Bhagavad Gita, which he published with Srila Viswanatha Chakravarti Thakur's commentaries and some of his own translations. And now Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur is again manifested in Srila Gurudev, who's presenting the Bhagavad Gita first for the Hindi-speaking world, and now it'll be for the Western world. And he also is very famous for discovering the appearance place of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. While he was working for the government, he wanted to move to Navadvip, but they wouldn't give him a transfer there. So he resigned, and they refused to accept his resignation, and they kept him in the service and transferred him. And then he lived just about 25 miles, I think, from Navadvip. And then later he lived in Godrumdweep, and he became more and more serious about discovering Lord Chaitanya's birthplace for the benefit of the world. So he began to make inquiries because he was finding that the place where he was, Navadvip, was just 100 years old. So it couldn't have been the real Navadvip. So he did inquiry to see where the real place of Lord Chaitanya's birth was. And some people told him that, well, now it's lost under the Ganges because of the change of the flow of the Ganges. But he wasn't satisfied with that. So from his own abode in Godrumadweep, he saw, after doing inquiries and finding out about one place on the Mayapur side, and very carefully studying ancient maps and speaking to advanced devotees there, they found that there was some piece of land where only tulsis could grow and nothing else could grow. And this was now under the ownership of Muslims. And he was becoming more and more convinced that this was the right place. And then from his abode, he saw an effulgent light coming from across the river. And then he had a vision that Lord Chaitanya and his Sankirtan party was actually also there in the effulgence. So he brought Srila Jagannath Das Babaji Maharaj, his Guru Maharaj, to the spot in a basket. He was so old and he couldn't even see. His eyelids were drooping over his eyes and he couldn't open them. But when he arrived at the place, he jumped way up in the air, even though previously he couldn't even walk. And this confirmed that it was the right place. And later on, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur himself went door to door to establish a temple there at the Yogapith, I think the Gaura Vishnupriya temple. And there was one newspaper called Amrita Bazar Patrika, which put out an article that now Baba Kedarnath Datta might be coming to your door, trying to collect 1 or 2 rupees from each person for this temple. So any sincere gentleman should give him something, and that way, practically single-handedly, he collected the money for the temple and established the temple. And of course we know he wrote so many wonderful books like Kalyana Kalpatru, with the Sharanagati prayers and Gitavali prayers, which gives the same siddhantas as the scriptures, but in simple Bengali language and in the first person, the I mode, so that the reader, us, we conditioned souls, can relate to our own fallen position, understand our present condition, and at the same time understand how to become free from it by praying in ways that he expresses on our behalf. So I don't want to take up more time because I'm sure other devotees would like to speak. Thank you. Thank you.
Navin Krishna Brahmachari will speak some. We can operate the workshop. Amen.
ओमज्ञानतिमिरान्धस्वज्ञानाञ्जनशलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः. नमो भक्तिविनोदाय सच्चिदानन्दनामिने गौरशक्तिस्वरूपाय रूपानुभवराय ते वाञ्छाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपासिन्धुभ्यैव च पतितानं पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः. हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे. फर्स्ट अफ अल आई कन्वे माई हाम्रो दण्डवत प्रणाम लोटसपीठ अफ गुरु महाराज. आफ्टर द्याट अल वैष्णवस हु असेम्बल हियर टु हियर द ग्लोरी अफ श्री भक्तिविनोद ठाकुर एन्ड श्री गदाधर पण्डित गोस्वामी. एज बिफोर यु हेभ हर्ड फ्रम पूज्यपाद भयेश्वर प्रभु एन्ड पूज्यपाद श्यामरानी दिदी. दे एक्सप्लेन सो मेनी थिङ्स अबाउट भक्तिविनोद ठाकुर. Which you have heard from my Gurudev, I try to explain. If there is any mistake, please excuse me. Srila Bhaktivinod Thakur explained in his Jaiva Dharma from top to bottom of sadhana how one devotee can progress in sadhana life. He explained everything in Jaiva Dharma. If anyone wants to progress in Krishna consciousness, he has to go through Jaiva Dharma, then easily he can enter in realm of Krishna. At first he explained in Jaiva Dharma first chapter the eternal sarup, the constitutional form of jiva. Jiva is the eternal servant of Supreme God, but he forget due to maya that he is servant of Krishna. Just like give an example, water came in contact of too cold, it became ice. The religion of water is liquidity, but barf, that means ice, is not liquid, it's too hard. As a same way, the religion of jiva is to service of God, but he forget, he thought that I am enjoyer of this material world. And the sarup of jiva he explained in Jaiva Dharma. The origin of jiva comes from Baladev Prabhu, Sankarsan and Karmadev Sai Vishnu. Who came from Baladev Prabhu? They are eternal associates of Supreme Personality Godhead Krishna in Braj. They are always engaged in Krishna service. They have no time to inquire that there is any material world and jiva is suffering there quite a lot. And second kind of jiva, they came from Sankarsan. They are also eternal associates of innumerable Vaikuntha. That means associates of Narayan, Vaman, Nrisimha, Ramchandra, etc., etc. They also engage so much. They have no time to inquire about material world that jivas are suffering here. Both of them are called associates. The eternal associates of Braj and eternal associates of Vaikuntha. And third kind of jiva came from Karmadev Sai Vishnu. Some of them, they went according to their position, some went Vaikuntha, some Ajodhya, some Dharaka, some Mathura, some Braj. And he who want to enjoy this material world, they entangled in Maya. And Maya bind them with three kinds of chains. One is called mode of ignorance, mode of passion, and mode of goodness. And he is thinking, I am injured and this suffering coming here. Then Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur is explaining how jiva can attain Krishna service. Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur gives his solution. If they take shelter of bona fide Gurudev and under guidance of Vaishnava and bona fide Gurudev, they can serve Krishna. And Prahlad Maharaj explained the same thing, that Guru Sushru Saya Bhakta Sarvala Bharpa Neenacha Sangheena Sadhu Bhakta Namishra Radha Neenacha. We have to respect Vaishnava, under guidance of Vaishnava, we have to take shelter of bona fide Gurudev. And we have to offer everything, our heart and soul. Gurudev already explained that I want only your heart. That means we have to offer everything and we have to do everything for his pleasure. If we do everything for pleasure of bona fide Gurudev, then we can do everything for pleasure of Krishna, Sri Krishna Chandra. And Srila Bhakti Thakur explained at last, who is Gauriya Sadhak, that means who came in line of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. After his perfection, his soul divided into two. By one he will serve Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in Navadvip Dham, by another he will serve Vrajanandan Samsundar in Braj. His main teachings in Dasmul Siksha, that means ten fundamental instructions. All instructions Bhakti Thakur put in one slope. Amnaya praha tattam harimya paramam sarvasaktim rasabdhim tad bhinnam sanscha jivan prakitikavalitam tad viluktamscha bhavar bheda bheda prakasam sakalopi sadhanam suddha bhaktim saddham tad pratim pudyasati janan gaura chandra sayansa. One praman and nine prameya. Amnaya means that which we get from Guru Parampara. There is so many things in Vedas and Upanishad. None can go easily, none can enter in Vedas through very easily. So we have to go through Guru Parampara. Which advice adopted by our Guru Parampara, we have respect them. It is called Amnaya. What are nature? That what am I proof? There are nine things he proves. What? Tattam harimya paramam. Krishna is supreme theory. Hari is supreme theory. Who is this Hari? Srimad Bhagavat. Sri Chakra Thakur Chal. Srimad Bhagavatam pramanam amalam. So in Bhagavatam, ete changsa kala pumsa krishnastu bhagavan swayam. Supreme personality Godhead is saying Bhagavan. Is Hari. Hari hi paramatattam and sarva saktim rasabdhim. He is omnipotent and rasabdhim, ocean of rasa. Krishna is ocean of rasa. I hope that a devotee know all these things, that Krishna is ocean of rasa, because you can see that one very little book, Krishna is ocean of rasa, in English our book table, compiled by the Gurudev, and it is translated into French language also. So no need to explain this point. Rasabdhin. That there is five prominent ras and seven secondary ras. Santa, Dasa, Hasa, Santa, Dasa, Sakha, Vatsala, Madhur, these five are prominent, and Hasa, Karun, Rodra, Bhayanath, Vibhatsa. These seven are secondary ras. Krishna is ocean of all ras. Srimad Bhagavatam explain it in one slok, Malla nama sanirinam naro rastrinam smaro murtiman, in this slok. So, Hari param tattam sarva saktim rasabdhim tad bhinnam sthang sangscha prakitika valitan. Jeev is part and particle. This jeev is two types. One is liberated soul, another is conditioned soul. And they are simultaneously different and non-different from God. That Vedavada Prakasam means, not only for Jeev, that means potency and Shaktiman, that Almighty, they are simultaneously different and non-different. Sakalvapi sadhanam, hare suddha bhakti. What is sadhan? Sadhan means by which means we can attain service of Krishna, it is called Shuddha Bhakti. That means pure devotion. Prabhupada Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur explained it in Sri Chaitanya Charitamrita commentary. Shuddha Bhakti means pure devotee means, pure devotion means spontaneous devotion. So, sadhanam suddha bhaktim, there is two types of devotion, regulative devotion and continuous devotion,
spontaneous
devotion. Krishna may be pleased by regulative devotion, but none can control Krishna by regulative devotion. So, Srila Prabhupada, Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Goswami Thakur explained that pure devotion means raganuga bhakti. Sadhanam suddha bhaktim and sadha, what is the destination? Tat priti vyapati bodhisati, tat priti. Tat means in this world there is three things, two things. One is called tat padartha and tan padartha. Srila Gurudev explained day before yesterday. Tat means Krishna. That means the pleasure of Krishna is our supreme goal. Tat priti. Then Srila Prabhupada explained so many things about his pleasure, Krishna's pleasure. It must be pleased Krishna and it will be very testable for Krishna. Like as Srila Gurudev gave an example that Mother Yashoda twisting Krishna's ears, and Krishna wants to take her breast, but Mother Yashoda shall sit down here. By one hand, he takes Krishna and by force, he put back to Krishna on the floor. Krishna began to eat. Began being Supreme Personality Godhead, he could not do anything because due to love of Mother Yashoda. Krishna is weeping here. In another hand, Chanur and Mustik, Krishna wrestling with them, and Krishna is very happy and testing heroism. Why it is not pure devotion? Why not? All activity of Mother Yashoda for welfare of Krishna. Krishna is weeping here, but Yashoda's inner mood is to please Krishna. How Krishna will be very good boy in future? Yashoda is ever well-wisher of Krishna, but Chanur Mustik, they fight to wrestle with Krishna, but the inner mood, how to smash Krishna? So it is not bhakti. So, Sad Priti, here in during wrestling with Chanur and Mustik, Krishna became very happy and testing heroism. Here it is not bhakti. Another hand, the Yashoda make weep to Krishna, yet it is uttama bhakti. The Sadham Tat Pritim, Epadasari Janan Gauratanya Sansa, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu taught all this theory for whole world. Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur mercifully taken all these things and make a garland in one slope. This is the best contribution of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur. And another thing, the contribution of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he discovered Navadvip Dham. And another, he discovered Prabhupada Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Goswami Thakur. If Bhaktivinoda Thakur not come in that time, none can know that where is Navadvip Dham? What is the birthplace of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu? Trying the help of, taking the help of Srila Jagannatha Saraswati Maharaj and taking map, old map from London National Library, and he proves that this is the birthplace of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And he discovered and present the whole world Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Goswami Thakur. Today you are seeing that a very big preaching is going on. Who is the origin of this preaching theory? Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur. Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur present Srila Prabhupada in this world. And he preached Namhatra. That people can assemble somewhere time to time and they can discuss so many things. about devotee, devotion and God. So Bhaktivinoda Thakur taught all these things for devotee. So he has so many things and he composed so many things in his literature. In Chaitanya Charitamritam, in his commentary, Amrit Prabhava Bhasha, he taught so many things. Śrīla Chaitanya, Śrī Chaitanya Charitamrita Grantha is so deep. Without commentary of Śrīla Bhaktivinoda Thakur or Śrīla commentary of Śrīla Prabhupāda, none can enter in Chaitanya Charitamrita. Śrīla Bhaktivinoda Thakur had done so many things. Just like our six Goswamis, Śrīla Rūpa Goswami, Śrīla Sanatana Goswami, Śrīla Raghunadas Goswami, Śrīla Jīva Goswami, Śrīla Gopāla Bhatta Goswami, Śrīla Raghunatha Bhatta Goswami. He did same thing. So all Gaudiya Vaishnav giving charity of that Saptam Goswami, that means seventh Goswami. As before, after sixth Goswami, no one get this title, that seventh Goswami. And after that, up to date, no one is eighth Goswami. Gaudiya Vaishnav give him the title. So, another activity and teachings of Śrīla Bhaktivinoda Thakur, we shall hear from another Vaishnav. And everybody is want to hear about Bhaktivinoda Thakur and Gadadhar Pandit from Śrīla Lotus Feet of Śrīla Gurudev. And that thing, that Śrīla Bhaktivinoda Thakur ko namo bhakti vinodaya Satchidananda Namine Gaura Shakti Sarupaya Rupanuga Varayate. How he did so many things? Simultaneously, his eternal servitors, eternal associates of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and same time, eternal associates of Divine Kapil. Namo Bhakti Vinodaya, who give pleasure to Divine Kapil by devotion, so he is Bhakti Vinod. Satchidananda Namine, and he is like transcendental. Gaura Shakti Sarupaya, who is Gaura Shakti, who is potency of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu? Gadadhar Pandit. He is manifestation of Gadadhar Pandit. So Gaura Shakti Sarupaya. Namo Bhakti Vinodaya Satchidananda Namine Gaura Shakti Sarupaya Rupanuga Varayate. Rupanuga Varayate means, Varaya means Shrestha. He is best among Rupanuga Vaishnav at his time. Rupanuga means the eternal associates of Krishna, it is they call Ragadmik. Iste sarasiki raga parama vishtata bhave tanmeya bhaved bhakti satra ragadmiko dita. With eternal associates, they have eternally affection for Krishna, they call Ragadmik. And who hearing activity of Ragadmik Jan, who have agreed to adopt these things, that friends are playing with Krishna, they are serving with Krishna, Mother Yashoda and Nanda Baba, Upananda Vinanda, they are serving Krishna, Gopis are serving Krishna. If anybody have agreed, hearing all these pastimes, and want to serve same mood, they are following how to proceed this theory, they call Raganuga. That Ragatmika Manusrita Jasa Raganuga Chate, who is following Ragatmik Jan, they call Raganuga. And Bhaktivinoda Thakur is called Rupanuga Varayate. Among our six Goswamis, Rupa Goswami is best. So Rupa Goswami, he act in two forms. One is sadhak form, another is siddha form. Seva sadhaka rupena siddha rupena chatrahi tad bhava lipsunakarja prajaloka anusarata. Is performing all devotional activities as a Rupa Goswami and is serving Divine Kapil as a Rupa Manjari. So who follow Rupa Goswami in externally and internally, both, they are called Rupanuga. They are following Rupa Goswami's all theory. by Sadhak Sarir and another by Siddha Sarir. So among of them, Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur is best in his times. So Rupa Anuga Varayate. So at first Agadmik, after that who follows Agadmik, they are Rupa Anuga. Among Rupa Anuga, who is followers of Srila Rupa Goswami, internally and externally, they are called Rupa Anuga. All Rupa Anuga are Raga Anuga, but all Raga Anuga is not Rupa Anuga. So after that, Srila Gurudev asking me to stop here. Everybody is facing towards me the lotus face, so I don't want to take much time. All of you, Hare Krishna. Pancha kalpata rupascha kripa sindhu bhayavacha parichanam bhavane ko hare ko.
Brahmachari will describe something.
Magyanatimiran tigyananyena shalakya chakshurun militam yena tasmai shri gurave namah pancha kalpatruvishya kripa sindhu bhayavacha Patidanam Pavane Bhyo Vaishnavi Bhyo Namo Namah Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhara Shivasadi Sri Guru Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Ram 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 Hare I offer my most humble obeisances to the lotus feet of Srila Guru Maharaj and I pay my proper respects to all the Vaishnava devotees who are present here and especially at the lotus feet of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur and pray so that I can offer Pushpanjali at his lotus feet to purify my own self, although I am fully incompetent to speak. Srila Gurudev has mercifully ordered me, so I'll try to carry out the orders of Srila Gurudev. Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur is among the most prominent acharyas of our Gaudiya Vaishnava Sampradaya. We know that when he appeared, at that time, Gaudiya Vaishnava Sampradaya went through a very dark period after the disappearance of Srila Vishwanatha Chakravarti Thakur, who was also, at his time, the most important acharya, and who very nicely exposed the teachings of Srila Rupa Goswami, which were actually misunderstood by so many people. But again, due to the course of time, as Krishna says, that this divine knowledge, though it is eternal, but it gets covered. It never finishes, but gets covered. So Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, I think about a difference of 100 years or 150 years after Srila Vishwanatha Chakravarti Thakur, he appeared. At that time, people in the society who belonged to good positions, educated people, they were actually hating to come near those who call themselves as Gaudiya Vaishnavas. Why? We heard from Shyamalani Didi also that how they were actually on the name of being the devotees of Mahaprabhu, they were simply engaged in sense gratification and so many abominable activities that people would hate. So actually people were really feeling very bad about the teachings of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, when he saw all those things, he felt a lot of pain in his heart, and he took the responsibility to again bring about the teachings of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in such a way to all the people so that they should understand that actually that there is nothing beyond than the teachings of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. His teachings are so pure and they're full of love, and that's what everyone is looking for. So very nicely, one after another, he started printing and publishing the teachings of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, which were given the form of books by Sri Goswamis and other acharyas like Chaitanya Chaitamrita, Bhakti Samit Sindhu and other literatures. And he himself also compiled very new books based on the same philosophy, but presented in such a way so that people at that time could understand. And Navin Prabhuji very nicely explained about Jaiva Dharma. There's so many other books, teachings of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and other things. So in those books, he presented the philosophy in such a sweet and comprehensive language that when people, they read these books, they started understanding that actually this philosophy is the best and there's no other thing which could be taken as an alternative, and it's actually the fault of these people who are not able to understand, and they are spoiling the image. And not only this, his own life, he practiced those teachings. It wasn't just coming to tell people, but he followed those teachings. As we know, he's eternal associate of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So these things are present in him, but still he acted as a conditioned soul. In whole of his life, he followed the four ashrams very nicely, giving examples that how being in this world, we can still carry out our material duties and we can achieve our spiritual goals. And he discovered the birthplace of Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and thus we know him as the Saptam Goswami or the seventh Goswami in our line. Many nice stories how he preached the Namhutta program in Odisha, Bengal and all those areas, and started inspiring people to come together as we are doing now, that they can come together and discuss the teachings of Mahaprabhu and thus can benefit their lives. And though it's Kali Yuga and we're all suffering with so many miseries and troubles, and always the mind is in tension, but by following these teachings of Mahaprabhu, we can keep ourselves always peaceful and happy. And thus, not only this, we can also achieve the highest goal a living entity can achieve, and that is love of Godhead. There's nothing beyond that. We also know once Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur was taken to heaven, and that was in regard to when all the demigods in the heaven, they were discussing on the verse of Bhagavad Gita, apichetso duracharo bhajate mamana nivag sadurim samantabhya samyak vyavasito hisa. So they could not understand that how Krishna is saying that even if you see faults in my devotee, do not criticize him, because by the dint of pure devotion, my bhakti, very soon he'll become purified. So they were not able to understand that what is the essence of this verse. So when they were very much confused and they were bewildered, so they were thinking what to do, and then they were told, I think, so they were told that now if they go to this earth, then Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur is present and he knows the real essence of this verse, and because he's the pure devotee and he's the eternal associate. So they all came. Yeah. So then he was sleeping one night, and during his sleep, they took Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur in the heaven, and he was there for about 2 days, and very nicely he reconciled the whole verse, and all the demigods were so happy to hear that, and then he came back. So he preached not just in this earth planet, but he preached all over the heaven, and that is also said in one of the prayers, Mahaprabhu Gana Sabhapatita Pavan, Brahmanda Tarita Shakti Dhare Jane Jane, that the associate of Mahaprabhu, all the associates are so powerful that just by their one hand they can deliver the whole world. And Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur was also capable, but mercifully they always keep something for other devotees to come and do some service for Mahaprabhu. So Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur very nicely did all these things, and we can speak endlessly on this, and I'm too small and not knowing so much, so we'll request the Gurudev to speak on his wonderful life so that we can all benefit and learn. But I humbly pray at the lotus feet of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur that he can always bestow upon us his causeless mercy, that we can understand his teachings and thus dedicate our lives with all the sincerity to follow the teachings of Mahaprabhu and please Srila Guru Maharaj, so that we can perfect our lives. Panchakalpa.
will have to come up and he will just say something.
Om Agyana Tamarandasa Ganajana Shalakaya Chakshum Tumtina Tasmai Shri Gurudev Maha. Before speaking, I'd like to offer my humble obeisances unto the lotus feet of my divine Diksha Guru, Srila Gaurangavan Maharaj. Also, I'd like to offer my humble obeisances unto the lotus feet of my Shiksha Guru, Srila Bhakti Dantanaya Maharaj, and also unto the lotus feet of my Param Guru, Srila A.C. Bhaktivinoda Swami Maharaj, Srila Prabhupada. So, devotees have been speaking very nicely and covering many, many topics regarding Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur. So, I would like to briefly just give a bit of a biographical sketch of the life of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur. Some years back, I read a book which was put out by a devotee, Sriman Rupa Vilas, the Seventh Goswami. So what I can recall from that, then I'll speak, and if there are whatever mistakes I make, please correct me so I don't send anybody astray. So Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he appeared in a village called Uliyagram as Kedarnath Dutt. It's explained that his parents, both mother and father, they came from very aristocratic stock. And from a very early age, he was always very interested in understanding the nature of the Lord, universe, spiritual subject matter. And he would always inquire whether it be to, he explains that in his autobiography that there was one chokidar, kind of a watchman, who was a Ram Bhakta. In his early days, he was a bit of a dacoit, but he was always chanting Ram. So, Srila Bhakti Kedarnath would go and speak with him, hear stories of Lord Ramachandra. Even if he came in contact with Mohammedan Fakir, Mohammedan holy man, he would also go, and he was very inquisitive to know. So, in his youth, he was well educated. His parents sent him to a school in Krishna Nagar, where they had the children of the influential and affluential Bengali families. And he excelled in school, but due to sickness, he had to go back to his village. And after some time, he was sent to Calcutta, where he went to college. And it's explained that at that time also he excelled, but also he became open to Christian theology because it was some type of Christian school that he was studying at in Calcutta. And this inner quest to understand the absolute truth that took shape in the form of reading Christian theology. And about the same time he came in contact with many intellectual people in Calcutta, both amongst the British Raj and also amongst the Bengali intelligentsia. Specifically, there's a family called the Tagore family. One of the Tagores, I think his name is Rabindranath Tagore, he was a Nobel Prize winner. And one of the relatives was a Navindranath Tagore, who was a very close friend of Bhaktivinoda Thakur. So, in Bhaktivinoda Thakur's autobiography explained that they were very, very close friends, but the Tagore family, they followed a particular philosophy called Brahmoism. And they tried to convince Kedarnath, but Kedarnath said that he was not so inclined towards this Brahmoism because he, at that time, was more inclined to the teachings of Jesus Christ because they were personal in nature, whereas Brahmoism was impersonalism. It was kind of, from what I can recollect, a khichdi of taking the Upanishads and different parts of the Vedas, the impersonalistic aspects, and dabbing that with a bit of Christianity and they came up with on Brahmanism. So it was explained that during that time, the British, they, in their way to dominate India, their policy was that whatever aspects of Indian culture, specifically the scriptures, religious rituals, that they would condemn and just put down as being pretty much hodgepodge. So, and also the young intellectual Indians that would come up in the system, they would train them to be English in mentality, even though physically they were Indian. So under such situation, then the, especially the Bengali intellectuals, they took to this Brahmanism, and it became very, very prevalent. But during this time, Kedarnath, that he was not really so much attracted to this. So it's explained that he had to leave Calcutta because I think there was some sickness in the family or some kind of devastation in his village. And he had to take up taking care of his family, his mother. By this time he was a married man. So he had different jobs, and it explains how he had so many different jobs throughout his life. And at one point he came in contact with Vaishnav sadhus, and he got the Chaitanya Charitamrita. So he explains that reading Chaitanya Charitamrita, then immediately he could appreciate the sublime teachings and pastimes of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And at one point he said that in reading Chaitanya Charitamrita, the bhava very quickly arose in him. So after coming in contact with Vaishnav scriptures, he would always search out sadhus, and he became more and more absorbed in the Vaishnav teachings. So we can see that though Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he's an eternal associate of the Lord, but the Lord, he used him in a particular way that, as has been mentioned earlier, that it is through him that the worldwide preaching has come about. So he being the first acharya in this way, he was educated in the Western system, and he had a very broad way of dealing with different religions. His approach was very non-sectarian, and this was so much appreciated by people of the of his time, that when there were disputes between the caste Hindus and those following Brahmanism or what have you, then they would call upon Kedarnath Das to try and resolve the situation, because everybody appreciated that he was a very learned, open, and broad-minded person. This would sometimes backfire in the sense that in presenting the Vaishnav conclusion, then sometimes both parties would get annoyed with him because he would not side with either but present the teachings of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So, as has been explained also, after some time he resided in Jagannath Puri, and he held the post of deputy magistrate, which was the highest post that could be held by an indigenous citizen of the time. And he would take care of, he would oversee the worship of Lord Jagannath in the temple. And he explains that he experienced great bliss going daily to the temple of Lord Jagannath, taking darshan. And also he would have Bhagavat discourses, Bhagavat Pravachan, in a particular part of the Jagannath temple. So one pastime that comes to mind is having these discourses, he would have the different Vaishnavas would come and they would sit down and discuss, and in another part there would be people discussing philosophy from an impersonal point of view. So I think it was in the Vallabha Gardens that the discussions would go on. And one elderly Vaishnava, a Babaji, he was not so much in favor of the devotees going to sit and speak with Kedarnath Das, because he's saying that he was not wearing neck beads, and he was not externally showing the symptoms of a Vaishnava. And he kind of started a bit of a boycott of the Katan. But I can't remember exactly, but one night in a dream, this devotee, he was actually a very exalted person. He became sick, and in a dream, he was chastised for his treating Kedarnath Das like this. So when he got up in the morning, immediately he ran over to where Bhaktivinoda Thakur was staying and he begged forgiveness. And Bhaktivinoda Thakur, he replied that, please forgive me, what is my fault for not wearing Kunti Mala, that Lord Mahaprabhu has not sent my guru to me yet. So because of this, I'm not wearing, because the tradition, from what I can understand, is that that the guru will give the neck beads. So Bhaktivinoda Thakur explains that this elderly Babaji then became very affectionate to Bhaktivinoda Thakur and would give him shelter. So in Jagannath Puri, he would associate with so many devotees. Then after that, he was posted to different places, but as been explained, he also was posted near Navadvip, and I believe close to the end of his manifest pastimes, then he stayed in a place which is in Jagannath Puri, near the Haridas Thakur Samadhi, where he wound up his lila. So I cannot remember much more. Hare Krishna. Thank you. Thank you.
Gyanatmarandasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chakshurin Militam Gyena Tasmai Sri Gurave Namaha Namo Bhakti Vinodaya Sachit Ananda Namine Gaura Shakti Swarupaya Rupanu Harayate Bancha Kalpaturu Vyascha Kripa Sindhu Deva Cha Patitanam Bhavane Jo Vaishnava Namo. Just offer my obeisances to the feet of Srila Gurudev and to all the Vaishnavas. So many things have already been explained about Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur. There are, you can say, two tendencies in as far as misrepresentation of the teachings of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. The one tendency is sahajiyism, to take cheaply the teachings of Mahaprabhu. And there are so many different sects of sahajiyism. At the time of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, there were 13 prominent sects of sahajiyism. And they also make use of the literature of the Goswamis, especially Chaitanya Charitamrita and Ujjwala Nilmani, and other books. And they will quote these books and try to establish that they can, in various ways, imitate the mood of the Lord's eternal associates in an unauthorized way. And the other tendency is to completely neglect the mood of spontaneous devotion following in the mood of the residents of Braj, and to reduce the teachings of Mahaprabhu simply to rules and regulations, the path of Vaidhi Marg. So, both of these tendencies will not allow us to actually capture the true essence of what Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came to give. And we find, both in the personality of Bhaktivinoda Thakur, in his behavior, in his the example that he set, and especially in his voluminous writings, that he established the true conclusions of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu to dispel and eradicate both of these tendencies. If we simply examine the number of books written by Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, it is astonishing. He wrote over 100 books, and he wrote in 6 different languages. He wrote in Sanskrit, Bengali, Hindi, English, Urdu, and Oriya. So this is an extraordinary feat. And in some years, he wrote as many as 6 different books, some of them very large books. So it is quite extraordinary. And in those books, he presented many revolutionary concepts. He took the essence of the teachings of the 6 Goswamis, and he presented them in a very extraordinary manner. Some of these things have already been described. Naveen Prabhu gave a very nice description of Jiva Dharma. So, and also of Dasmulam, which is one of the most prominent concepts that we find throughout the books of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur. There is one book, Bhagavad Arka Marichimala, in which the whole book is discussing this concept of Dasmula very elaborately. I won't describe it again because it's already been nicely described. I just wanted to add one thing, that this Dasmula, it is also further divided into the topics of Sambandha, Abhideya, and Prayojan. So, of the 9 pramayas, or the 9 fundamental principles which are established by the praman, or by the shastra, the first 7 fall under the category of Sambandha Tattva, understanding one's relationship with the Lord. So, understanding different aspects of the Lord, His energies, and the living entities, and the interrelationship between all of these, all come under the category of Sambandha Gyan. So 7 of these 9 pramayas fall under that. Then the next one is Abhideya Tattva. So Abhideya Tattva refers to that process by which we can attain the goal of life. So this refers to the path of bhakti. And it refers specifically to bhakti beginning from, or in the stage of sadhana, beginning from shraddha up to the stage of asakti. And prayojan tattva, which is the 9th principle, refers to sadhya, the goal, or the goal to be obtained by bhakti. So this is including both bhav and prem. So in this book he has described all these things, and I think it's at the very end of the book he says that I must explain how the vision of this book came to me. He said, in one sense I feel ashamed to admit it, because if I admit it, then some persons will think that I am proud. And yet on the other hand, if I don't admit it, then I will not be giving credit to the person from whom this revelation came. So he says that the revelation of this book came to him in a dream from Surup Damodar Goswami. And he revealed to him how to summarize the entire Srimad Bhagavatam. This Bhagavad Arkamarichimala consists of approximately 300 shlokas. So they're all from Srimad Bhagavatam. So he explained to Bhaktivinoda Thakur how to summarize the entire Bhagavatam into these 300 shlokas. And according to the divisions of Sambandha, Abhideya, and Prayojan, and then also according to the explanation of Dasmula. So, by this and so many incidents of the life of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, we get some insight into what kind of a person he was. He was not an ordinary person at all. He was an eternal associate of the Lord. Also in Navadvip Bhavataranga, in the final portion of the book, he explains his eternal swarup as Kamala Manjari. And he gives a very elaborate description there of his form and the services that he performs there. So by doing this, he has both indicated his what his actual position is, and he is also teaching us what is the process for us to advance. So in all the books that he has written, he has given a very systematic presentation of the philosophy of Lord Chaitanya, beginning from basic concepts, like Naveen Prabhu was describing in the beginning of Jiva Dharma. He was explaining what is the actual swarup of the jeev, and how the jeev should be first established. He's also discussed in many of his books Varnashram Dharma as a platform to enter into bhakti. And then he describes bhakti beginning from Shraddha and described elaborately what is Vaidhi Bhakti, what is Raghunuga Bhakti. And especially in Jiva Dharma, he has explained all the teachings, or the essence of all the teachings, of Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu and Ujjwal Nilmani. From chapter 19 onwards, the last 20 or so chapters of the book, he has given all the essential teachings of these two books of Srila Rupa Goswami through the form of this wonderful story. And as Srila Gurudev has explained many times, is not, we shouldn't take it as just some novel. It is such an extraordinary book. It is the only book that we can compare it with is Brihat Bhagavatamrit in its style, because it is telling a story, but again, not as an ordinary novel, but as a series of exchanges between different Vaishnavas and teaching all the siddhanta through the exchanges that take place through those Vaishnavas. So in this way, he has established all the conclusions of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. He has eradicated the various sahajiya groups, and also, but at the same time, established very strongly what is our actual process. Nowadays, we find that some persons, they say that we should not even mention the word Raghunuga, and we should not discuss about what is Bhava Bhakti, what is Prema Bhakti, and what is the mood of the residents of Braj. We should not discuss 10th canto Srimad Bhagavatam. So these, some of these ideas are being presented nowadays. But I think that persons that are presenting such ideas, that they must have never read any of the books of Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur. Because if anyone studies any one of his books, then they have to see that all of these conclusions are in his books, beginning from basic level up to the topmost level. So he has actually taught through the method, how he has presented his books, how we are meant to follow. First by understanding all of the Siddhanta regarding Sambandha Gyan, then how to practice bhakti, what is the eligibility for Vaidhi bhakti, what is the eligibility for Raganuga bhakti, how to practice these things. And in so many of his books, such as Bhajan Rahasya, and in many of his song books also, he is taught in a very practical and concrete way how to practice bhajan in order that we can obtain this goal which Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came to give. So we are greatly indebted to Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur for giving us all these books, for planting the seed by which the mission of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu could be spread throughout the world. If it was not for his mercy, we would not be all gathered here right now, glorifying him, and receiving tremendous inspiration from his very dear follower, our Gurudev, Srila Bhaktivedanta Narayan Maharaj. So, I will stop here.